Thank you very much for having me. My name is Rick Swartz. I'm a stroke neurologist and researcher at Sunnybrook Hospital with the University of Toronto. I'm the medical director of our stroke program and have an interest in vascular cognitive impairment. And I also serve as the principal investigator for ONDRI, the Ontario Neurodegenerative Disease Research Initiative that's funded by the Ontario Brain Institute. So we're going to be talking today about vascular cognitive impairment and doing a brief update on how to find it and what to do about it. Stroke is the leading cause of adult neurological disability in Canada. It's the fourth leading cause of death, and it is extremely common, with 62,000 new strokes annually and almost 500,000 Canadians living with the effects of stroke. Stroke is not a single disease, though. As you know, stroke can be ischemic with a blockage in blood flow. It can be hemorrhagic with a bleed. You can have microinfarcts or even what we call covert infarcts, but we see them on the scans, but the patient has no symptoms. You can have problems with blood flow that cause watershed infarcts. So there's lots of different things that can cause stroke. And vascular cognitive impairment is like that too. So there's a lot of different names for vascular cognitive impairment, and this alphabet soup can summarize that. You have vascular dementia, VAD, vascular SIND, cognitive impairment, not demented. You have MCI, mild cognitive impairment of a vascular sort. You can have, from the DSM-5, major and minor neurocognitive disorders. There's a lot of different types of names for the same syndrome. And what it fundamentally boils down to is cognitive impairment with a vascular contribution. It's really important to recognize that 1 in 3 Canadians will suffer from stroke, dementia, or both in their lifetimes. So vascular cognitive impairment is actually the second most common cause or form of dementia, and it's the most common mixed type when different diseases coexist. It can overlap with lots of different pathologies, not just Alzheimer's disease, but with the kinds of pathologies that cause Parkinson's disease or ALS and FTD. Overt symptomatic stroke, covert stroke, small vessel disease, bleeding, even vascular risk factors can all contribute. So there are these multiple different ways that vascular disease can contribute to cognitive impairment. The first and most obvious is that someone can have a symptomatic stroke and result in cognitive impairment. The stroke causes a disconnection or an injury to the brain that makes cognition harder. Strokes can also unmask latent neurodegeneration. So somebody might have neurodegenerative disease building up, but be compensating for it, and the stroke can cause a decompensation. You can also have small vessel disease changes that affect cognition. You can have neurodegenerative diseases that actually increase your stroke risk. So a classic example of that is amyloid angiopathy. We'll talk about that in a moment. And then vascular risk factors and even heart disease can accelerate neurodegeneration. So fundamentally, all roads lead to Rome. There's multiple different routes that get you to the same place. Let's look at the first one for a second. Strokes causing cognitive impairment. One of the more classic is these strategic infarcts, like a stroke affecting the thalamus or a stroke affecting the medial temporal lobe. These are situations where a patient may be fine at one moment and have a sudden stepwise change in the way they can think or remember or behave. You can also have multi-infarct dementia, where you get multiple strokes from watershed injuries, from atrial fibrillation, or other cardioembolic causes. Multiple different stroke causes can result in having more than one infarct, but this cumulative change can cause lots of cognitive impairment. As we mentioned, stroke can unmask neurodegeneration. The classic here is the Nunn study. This was published many years ago in the late 90s, and the group here followed an order of Christian nuns in the United States with detailed characterizations in life, and they all agreed to donate their brains to autopsy. And this was one of the first indications about how much neurodegenerative pathology can build up without causing symptoms. So they found that just over half of people who actually met pathological criteria for Alzheimer's disease, less than 60% of them actually expressed symptoms of dementia while they were alive, if all they had was the amyloid or tau problems of Alzheimer's disease. But if they also had any amount of small vessel or cortical strokes, plus their pathology, they had a 20-fold risk of expressing dementia symptoms. This is the unmasking we talked about. We also know that 10% of people in a stroke population will have dementia before their first stroke. 10% more will acquire dementia after having a stroke. And 35% of people will have dementia after having more than one stroke. And that's just dementia, which is the most severe end of the spectrum. When you look at cognitive impairment of all types, almost 65% of stroke survivors have some amount of cognitive impairment. In autopsy studies, they also confirmed, this is a more recent study from 2007, where they looked at a population of people with dementia and a population of people without dementia. And you can see that the mixed disease phenotype is much more common in those that express dementia symptoms. So we talked about those first two ways that vascular disease can contribute to cognitive impairment. Small vessel disease is another route that vascular effects can impact cognition. There's also a term called CVID, which stands for subcortical ischemic vascular disease. You can get lots of different impacts on the small vessels. They can become thick, they can become closed off. This is lipohyalinosis. They can get tortuous and twisted, which increases resistance and makes it harder for blood to get through. You can get changes to the perivascular area so that amyloid, tau, and other pathologies aren't drained or cleared as well from the brain. And you can get changes in the blood-brain barrier. Neurodegenerative pathologies can also contribute to strokes directly. So amyloid is one of the classic proteins involved in Alzheimer's disease. It can also build up in blood vessels. In Alzheimer's disease, it's deposited in the neurons, but when it's deposited in the vessels, it's a slightly different variant of amyloid that contributes to cerebral amyloid angiopathy, CAA. And CAA can actually gum up those small blood vessels and cause them to block off, which causes ischemic strokes, but can also cause them to weaken and rupture and bleed. So you can get both hemorrhages and ischemic strokes in the same patients. Finally, vascular risk factors can accelerate neurodegeneration. So midlife hypertension is one of the key contributors to late life cognitive decline and incident dementia. Indeed, primary prevention of dementia really happens in the MINT clinics. It happens in primary care. It happens wherever people are treating blood pressure for primary prevention. It's the only proven therapy that actually does do something to reduce potentially the risk of later life cognitive impairment or incident dementia. Hypertension does a lot of bad things to the vessels, including triggering vascular remodeling, disrupting autoregulation, reducing cerebral perfusion, and limiting the brain's ability to clear toxic proteins as they build up. Midlife vascular risk factors beyond hypertension, like smoking, diabetes, these are all associated also with later life dementia. Indeed, the risk, the hazard ratio associated with having diabetes at midlife, the hazard ratio for having later life dementia is about the same as having an APOE epsilon 4, APOE 4 allele, which is one of the genetic contributors to sporadic late life Alzheimer's disease. We also know that even having heart failure, NYHA functional class, is an independent predictor of cognitive decline in people with CHF. So vascular risk factors are important causes of cognitive impairment. There's multiple resources for how to manage vascular cognitive impairment. The Canadian Stroke Best Practice Recommendations, with the website listed there, has a chapter on mood, cognition, and fatigue. And it's an excellent resource for especially secondary prevention, but even primary prevention. The Canadian Consensus Conference on the Diagnosis and Treatment of Dementia has the fourth edition available right now. The fifth edition is actually going to be coming out this year, so watch for that. And the CHEP guidelines, the Canadian Hypertension Education Program guidelines, have really good guidelines that I'm sure you are familiar with for the management of hypertension, and there's a specific chapter on hypertension with stroke. Just to summarize some of the different ways that we can identify vascular cognitive impairment, there are multiple criteria. These are some of the more common and the more modern ones that are listed here. They have some better sensitivity and better specificity than some of the older criteria. They all overlap in content, and indeed many of them overlap in their authorship, and they share certain key themes, the two most important of which are, in order to diagnose vascular cognitive impairment, you have to have evidence of some vascular disease, and you have to have evidence of cognitive impairment. To get evidence of vascular disease, we have to image. So if somebody has a history of an overt stroke with an obvious stroke on imaging, that can suffice. Generally speaking, MRI is a preferred modality than CT, if it's available and where it's available. Indeed, the 3 Tesla, the stronger MRI, is even preferred over the 1.5 Tesla. But if an MRI is available, even at 1.5T, that would be ideal. And the reason is we can see a lot more on an MRI than we can see on a CT scan. And the purpose of the imaging is both to rule out other pathologies as well as to assess for vascular disease that may be contributing to cognitive impairment. Interestingly, we've done a study through ONDRI where we looked at clinical trials in Alzheimer's disease, and many of them do not even include requirements for imaging, which means that we may be testing new therapies without identifying a pure population of participants. Some specific scenarios where MRI would be ideal would be when there's a recent onset of cognitive decline within the last less than 2 years, if there's been stepwise change, either a stepwise onset or on the background of a more gradual decline, if there's been a sudden stepwise drop, if there's a neurological history to raise concerns. So that would be, for example, a significant head trauma, a seizure, severe headaches, or abrupt change in confusion as mentioned. If there's a cancer history, this would also be a red flag, especially if it's a type of cancer like breast or lung cancer that's commonly associated with brain metastases. If there's focal neurological deficits, either an upgoing toe, gait difficulty, facial droop, something like that, that would point you towards a focal lesion, then MRI would be preferred. If there's a patient at high risk of bleeding, intracranial hemorrhage, and a score that you can use to even calculate a person's risk is the HASBLED score, H-A-S-B-L-E-D. If somebody has many vascular risk factors, we might want to think about an MRI as well. In an ideal world, if we can get an MRI, most of the guidelines are suggesting that the MRI actually be complete. So we would want a volumetric T1, we would want a flare, we would want a diffusion-weighted imaging to look at acute stroke, and we would want some kind of T2-weighted imaging, ideally with gradient echo or susceptibility-weighted images to tell us about bleeding. If CT is used, it is recommended that you actually specify in a request to do coronal reformats to look specifically at hippocampal atrophy. For either MRI or CT requisitions, one of the most frustrating things to get back from a radiologist is a simple nil acute or no acute processes seen or changes as expected for age. And one of the defenses against that is to actually ask a specific question. And so what I would recommend, if possible, is to specifically ask the radiologist in your requisition, please rule out acute infarcts. Please rule out covert or chronic infarcts. That specific question will require them to answer it in their report, say there's no evidence of small infarcts or covert infarcts. In addition, you can request that they provide a validated visual rating scale. So for example, the MTA, the medial temporal atrophy scale, or the Fasikas scale, which looks at white matter disease burden. These kinds of validated scales may give you a sense if a patient has sort of mild, moderate, or severe, rather than getting a non-specific report that ends up saying clinical correlation is required. In addition to diagnosing the vascular, we also have to diagnose the cognitive impairment. And there are many different ways to do this. Office screening for cognitive impairment is by necessity brief and should be really considered a screen, not necessarily a diagnostic tool. It's not detailed neuropsychological testing, nor should it be. And there are a number of different tools that we have on the slides that can help you. You've heard of the MMSE, you've heard of the MoCA, the doc screen we're going to talk about in a moment, and there are more detailed and less detailed tasks that could be pursued. The idea is to do something that can be integrated into daily clinical practice in an efficient way that provides a good screening tool. Probably the most known, especially in vascular disease, is the MoCA, the Montreal Cognitive Assessment. It's a 30-point scale, takes about 10 minutes to apply. There's three versions, so if you're applying it multiple times in the same person, or as some of my patients have, if they're going out for coffee with their friends before their doctor's appointment and practicing the word list, if you mix it up, it gets a little harder for them to practice. It tests multiple different domains: executive function, memory, orientation, language, and visual spatial. My research group has also developed the DOC screen, which stands for depression, obstructive sleep apnea, and cognitive impairment. These three conditions are very common after stroke, and they can affect a lot of the impairment that we see. Especially subjective cognitive impairment is often associated with fatigue, sleepiness, which can be affected by sleep apnea, and/or by mood issues. And so it's important to screen for all three of these, especially if we're thinking about cognitive impairment and a neurodegenerative process. If we can treat depression, if we can treat sleep apnea, we may be able to improve cognitive functioning and maybe change somebody's trajectory who may not be on a neurodegenerative process. The DOC screen, like the MoCA, are both available freely for use in clinical settings. The DOC screen actually uses 10 points out of the MoCA with permission. So we use the 5-word recall, we use the clock drawing, and we use the 2 points for language function. We've studied it and shown that it's quite feasible. About 90% of people can complete the screen in less than 6 minutes. It's valid when we compare it to more detailed testing, and it can quickly identify people who are at very low risk, very high risk, and potentially intermediate risk for whom a little more assessment is warranted. If you identify vascular cognitive impairment in the clinic, what can you do about it? Is a common question that I get asked. Well, it's important to realize that there are both non-pharmacological and pharmacological interventions. So the guidelines suggest that non-pharmacological intervention should always be individualized. There's rehabilitation options that include compensation strategies, as well as direct cognitive skill training or direct remediation strategies. And this is elucidated in a fair bit of detail in the Canadian Stroke Best Practice Recommendation. So I'd encourage you, if you're interested, to follow up there. Memory concerns can be treated with compensation, as most of us do with external strategies like our cell phones, as well as non-electronic devices like lists and pen and paper, as well as internal strategies, and how to stop yourself, how to remind yourself, and how to cue yourself. Executive functioning can be treated with metacognitive strategy training and or even formal problem-solving strategies. Sometimes occupational therapists can help with this, and there are specific programs at large centers where they can offer specific training in these areas. One of the most accessible treatments for vascular cognitive impairment is actually exercise. Aerobic exercise should be considered an adjunct therapy for cognitive impairment, frankly, actually, whether it's vascular or non-vascular, but especially in vascular disease, given the benefits for cardiac and brain functioning. And there are impacts of aerobic exercise on attention, on working memory, on executive function that have been demonstrated. Post-stroke depression, post-stroke anxiety, and post-stroke sleep problems should also be addressed in case they're contributing. Pharmacological strategies can also be used for vascular cognitive impairment. First of all, we want to prevent more vascular disease. That's probably the most important intervention that we can do. So most of our patients, if we think they have vascular cognitive impairment, they really fit in the secondary prevention category, especially if they've had a symptomatic stroke or a TIA. If they have white matter disease or small vessel disease seen on a scan incidentally, they really fall in the primary prevention guidelines. And again, I'd refer you to the Canadian Stroke Best Practice Guidelines for primary prevention. Treating hypertension, treating vascular risk factors may actually reduce cognitive decline and reduce the risk of dementia. So this is probably the most important thing that we can do for people in their 40s and 50s to reduce the burden of dementia later. Blood pressure should be treated in all people who are either at high risk for cognitive impairment or actually already have experienced cognitive impairment, and especially if they've experienced a stroke. So the typical CHEP targets are less than 140 over less than 90 in someone who's had a stroke. And this is generally the accepted target. If there's diabetes, if there's renal disease, if there's other common indications, as per the usual guidelines, those targets get lower. In general, lower targets are probably better for younger people and middle-aged people. In frail elderly, going for very aggressive targets may actually be counterproductive, as it may worsen their cognition, increase their fatigue, and potentially increase their risk for falls. There was a really interesting study that just came out last year that's referenced in the slide deck that looked at aggressive blood pressure control targeting less than 120 over less than 80. And there was some suggestion that in some people, it may help reduce MCI development into incident dementia. May be a good target, especially for people who can handle it, but not everybody necessarily needs to be at super low blood pressures. Now, there are some scenarios that are a little more complex that don't fall neatly into the box of primary or secondary prevention. So for example, as we mentioned, people with subcortical white matter changes on MRI or CT, there's a lot of question of whether those patients should be on aspirin routinely. 4 or 5 years ago, we might have said yes, because aspirin was at that point recommended for primary prevention in people with vascular risk factors. So at that time, if I had a patient who had vascular risk factors, including age, male, high blood pressure, diabetes, high cholesterol, anything like that, and they had white matter disease, I'd say, well, let's treat them for primary prevention anyway. Currently, however, the pendulum has moved for primary prevention, and we don't routinely treat people with aspirin if they have vascular risk factors. And so now those patients with small vessel disease or white matter changes who don't actually have symptomatic or even covert strokes or infarcts seen on their scans, those patients, if they just have white matter disease, the recommendation is to not treat those patients with aspirin. Aspirin is reasonable, but admittedly, there's not a lot of good clinical trial data, and this may change over the next coming 5 or 10 years. If somebody is found to have covert or silent infarcts on their scan, they never had symptoms, but they have clear infarcts on their scans, those patients we really treat as secondary prevention. They've had a stroke, they just got lucky that it didn't affect something that resulted in overt symptoms. And so those patients we treat as secondary prevention, and we would consider aspirin for them. Another area of controversy is the role of antithrombotics, either antiplatelets like aspirin or anticoagulants like warfarin or the direct oral anticoagulants in patients with cerebral amyloid angiopathy. As we talked about, those patients are at risk of blood vessel rupture and bleeding, as well as ischemic strokes, and the right management for them is unclear. Generally speaking, if I have somebody with a history of bleeding or excessive microbleeds and superficial siderosis, this staining in the subarachnoid space, showing that they've had old bleeds, those are patients I am a little bit concerned about anticoagulating. But right now, our evidence actually doesn't tell us what the best solution is for those patients. So it does have to be customized a little bit. And patients who are at very high risk or having recurrent ischemic strokes, for example, in the setting of atrial fibrillation, may be considered for antithrombotics, even anticoagulants. Cholinesterase inhibitors like donepezil galantamine, rivastigmine, and the NMDA receptor antagonist memantine are both reasonable options for vascular cognitive impairment. But this recommendation is really based on small trials showing small magnitude benefits in cognitive outcomes. It's also worth noting that these indications are not actually directly Health Canada approved, that these medications are Health Canada approved for the treatment of Alzheimer's disease and not necessarily for vascular cognitive impairment. That said, there does seem to be a subset of patients who do seem to get significant benefit and many who may not get benefit. So a trial may be worthwhile. It is important if you're going to use cholinesterase inhibitors in these patients, especially in the cardiac or AFib, the slow AFib patients, to make sure that they don't have any QT prolongation. So in summary, vascular cognitive impairment is more than one thing. Lots of different pathologies and lots of different contributors can lead to cognitive impairment. So all roads can lead to Rome. Strokes can cause cognitive impairment. Strokes can unmask neurodegeneration. Small vessel disease can affect cognition. Small vessel pathologies can actually cause strokes and increase the risk of neurodegeneration. Vascular risk factors can actually contribute, and neurodegenerative diseases like cerebral amyloid angiopathy can actually accelerate stroke. I'd like to thank you very much for your time. I'd like to thank some of our funders, specifically through ONDRI, funded by the OBI, the Ontario Brain Institute.